see all of you tonight. I'm Lynette Celeste, and I'm the provost here at Fresno State. I'm very, very pleased to have such a good audience, and thank you for all coming this evening on this important issue. So on behalf of President Castro, again, and the entire university community, I'm very delighted to welcome you to Fresno State for this important dialogue about one of the most vexing and increasingly formidable challenges facing us today, managing water scarcity in the San Joaquin Valley and throughout California. In fact, as we just learned from PPIC survey earlier this week, for the first time ever, water and drought are seen as the biggest California issue that we face. It is inspiring to feel the energy in this room and see so many people who are leaders from so many different backgrounds and organizations who are committed to doing the hard work to find solutions to these challenges. This is our second community forum on water this year. We plan to build on this venue going forward. First, I want to express my sincere thanks to everyone involved with the California Water Institute and the Public Policy Institute of California for putting together this important event. Your hard work, innovative ideas, and effective leadership are critical in helping us move forward in this area. Both organizations are true leaders in finding creative and resourceful ways to manage water. The Water Institute is a key part of Fresno State's effort in water research and has a long history of developing innovative solutions and technologies to help businesses and improve the quality of life in communities across our region and around the world. And PPIC recently established Water Policy Center will indeed strengthen the bridge between rigorous research and real-world policy debates. Fresno State staff are proud to be part of the research expert network supporting this new center. I also want to acknowledge our panelists, each of whom will offer an important perspective on our water challenges. We're honored to have such a dynamic group of experts with us tonight. To our panelists and the rest of the attendees, I want to thank you for being here, for bringing your expertise, for your insights, and for your experiences. And I am very eager to hear how we will powerfully move forward to demonstrate commitment to helping California address our water issues. Like you, we take water very seriously here at Fresno State, and we've seen the impact of the drought right here on our campus. Just this week, we announced a number of water management measures, including leaving 130 acres of field crops fallow because of limited water supply. And we are committed to improving water use efficiency on our 1,000 acre farm while reducing applied water by 25% in 2015. Our approach in dealing with water issues is very straightforward. We encourage and nurture collaboration and engagement from our entire campus community, faculty, staff, and students, to raise awareness and to create solutions that make a difference. Earlier this year, more than 100 faculty and staff came from across the CSU system at our campus to talk about ways that we can address the drought and its impact, particularly on agriculture. That's the kind of collaboration and engagement that is evident here tonight. President Castro has also commissioned a water task force, which happened last fall. Recommendations from this effort include developing strong undergraduate and graduate programs in water and being a leader in the CSU system, the state, the nation, and the world relative to water. We are committed to being a full partner in these efforts. I thank you all for your participation here tonight. Thank you for your work that you're doing today, every day, and all that you do to benefit this community. And I wish all of you a very productive, informative, and stimulating discussion tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Ellen Hanak from the Public Policy Institute of California. So now it's my turn to thank you all for being here, and thank you to Lynette for that great introduction. We're just really delighted to have the opportunity to work together with our partners at Fresno State to start digging into some of the big challenges in water management here in the valley, which is really in some ways kind of ground zero for drought impacts in a lot of different ways. And so this is the first of what I hope is going to be a more regular series of events, maybe a couple times a year, that we'll hope to co-sponsor with Fresno State folks from the California Water Institute. And I want to also thank, we have a couple of event sponsors tonight that have helped to make this possible, the California Endowment and the S.C. Bechtel Jr. Foundation. So thanks to them. And then just a quick note of greetings and an apology from PPIC's CEO, Mark Baldessari, who was planning to be here and was on the program and had to sub for the associate survey director of the PPIC statewide survey, who just had a beautiful baby boy. So it was a happy reason to have to sub for somebody. But so he was up actually in Sacramento. We had an event today talking about the new survey results, and I'll just touch on those a little bit in my talk. And what Mark would have done if he had been here was just tell you a little snapshot about PPIC. For those of you who don't know us, we are a nonprofit organization based in San Francisco with an office also in Sacramento. We're 20 years old. We are basically a research organization that has a mission to do objective, nonpartisan work to bring information to bear on some of the big policy debates and issues in California. That includes water, but certainly not limited to water. So we do work on education and health and social services, on corrections, on fiscal and governance issues. And Mas Masumoto, who's a neighbor of yours down here in the valley, is a member of our board and helps to bring the remind us always about thinking about things in the valley. And one of the things that we try to do at PPIC is really think not just about what's happening in Sacramento, but also a lot of the decisions that are made are important for different regions around the state. There are a lot of local governments and agencies that matter a lot too. And so we're really trying to kind of expand our ability to interact and get input from and be relevant for folks in different parts of the state, including here in the valley. So the Water Policy Center that we just launched last month is kind of a continuation of building on work that we've been doing on water really since the early 2000s, and the very much consistent with PPIC's overall mission of trying to really bring objective, nonpartisan information to bear on these critical issues. In the work that we do on water, we try to do this in a way that involves a lot of researchers from around the state. And so the Water Policy Center is kind of a way of us expanding that mission and bringing really people from universities, from institutes, and so on. And so the Fresno State partners, including Sarge Green and David Zaldowski, are part of that network now. And our first product is what we were just, what you were able to get when you came in. It's a set of short briefing kits on key topics in California water. And I think there are 40 or 41 authors at this point. So you can kind of see different experts from around the state hoping to continue to build and evolve that network. But we're also hoping to do it in a way that really interacts in a meaningful way so that the work that researchers do is as relevant as possible to what's happening on the ground with practitioners and policymakers and stakeholders. And a key part of that is trying to make the work that we do not too jargonful and, you know, kind of easy to digest for people who are not necessarily experts in a particular area. We try to do it in a way that brings together expertise from different domains, the technical, the legal, the economics, all of those kind of things. And we try to do it in a way that really involves conversations with practitioners and policymakers along the way. And these kind of events are one of those ways to do that. And we're looking forward to being able to do more of that as we go on. So I think now I'll just tell you, give you a sense of what you've got in store tonight. I'm going to give you a short overview presentation, kind of some big picture on statewide water issues right now and issues for the valley. And we chose as a theme for this event drought and groundwater. Two big issues. Groundwater would be a big issue even if we didn't have a drought, given the new groundwater law that passed, but certainly in the context of the drought, it's both helping out in some ways, the fact that it's there and being able to make up for some of the lost surface water, but it's also a more bigger pressure point in a way. So we thought that this was a kind of good way to talk about a range of issues for the valley. And so after I give my brief overview, we're going to have a really great panel moderated by Mark Grossi from the Fresno Bee, who's been a long time expert on environmental and water reporting. So one of the few remaining folks in journalism who really are on this beat and know it. So that's a real resource that you have here in the valley with Mark. And the panel is going to include really trying to touch at least at a high level a spectrum of issues. So with Dave Orth from the Kings River Conservation District talking, who can really give a perspective on ag as well as broader things than that. And then Luke Serpa from the city of Clovis and Sue Ruiz from the self-help organization, which is really going to be able to have a provide perspective on some of the rural community issues that have really been in the spotlight even before the drought, and even more so now, I think. So with that, we're going to follow up with a reception to give people a chance to kind of talk and mingle. But before you can go to the reception, you got to fill this out. This is a little evaluation form. So this helps us to improve our events, so we would really appreciate it. It's voluntary, and it's anonymous. I did all the housekeeping, I think, right? Hannah's not in. Yes. So now I can get going with the presentation. And we're going to start the presentation with a quick video. This is one of the things that we put up on our website as part of the Water Center launch.
California is a water-rich state, something people don't often realize. That's because most of our precipitation falls in less populated regions north of Sacramento, while most water use occurs in drier regions further south and along the coasts. Precipitation also varies a lot from one year to next, with multi-year droughts a common feature. To support our economy, we've developed one of the world's most complex storage and distribution systems. Some 1,400 surface reservoirs store about 40 million acre-feet of water. That's roughly the amount cities and farms use in a typical year. And across the state, more than 500 groundwater basins store at least 3 times that amount underground. To move water to where we use it, federal, state, and local agencies also built thousands of miles of aqueducts and canals. This water system has served us well, but today it's under stress. A warming climate is shrinking the Sierra Nevada snowpack, which we now depend upon to store water for dry summer months. And changes are also needed to support a growing population and to help our troubled ecosystems. The key is to improve the reliability of water supply while reducing water demand.
Over the past 20 years, our large urban areas have made a lot of progress. Per capita water use have been steadily falling thanks to changing behavior and new technology. This needs to continue. Cities also need to keep improving local storage, cleaning up polluted groundwater basins, and capturing and reusing wastewater and stormwater as part of an integrated and diversified approach.
In some farming regions, the way we use groundwater is a major problem. Excessive pumping is causing land to sink and wells to go dry, making these regions more vulnerable to drought. In 2014, the legislature passed the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. This law requires local agencies to bring their basins into balance over the next 25 years by reducing pumping or finding more surface water to replenish groundwater.
The widespread adoption of advanced irrigation technology, like the system behind me, has helped California become an agricultural powerhouse. But declining water supply reliability and over-reliance on groundwater are major threats. It will be really challenging to implement the new groundwater law, but necessary for the long-term health of California agriculture.
Californians are making great strides in managing water. They're decreasing demand while improving supplies. Yet the road ahead is likely to be rough as population increases and our climate continues to shift. Here at PPIC, along with our research partners, we've identified a portfolio of actions that can help prepare California for the future.
Okay, I don't know if you recognize one of those stars of the video. Sarge was saying that at some point working with the videographer, he realized he was getting so sunburned that they agreed that he said it well enough. But so just to that, thought that was kind of a useful way of kind of kicking off some of these issues, and I just want to now run through a little bit of, you know, showing you a few graphs and touching on some topics related to challenges in the state and in the valley. This is a sort of useful reminder. This is average precipitation over time, and it's just a useful reminder that we're in a bad drought, but it's not the first bad drought that we've had, and in some ways that's an advantage because we have some capability to deal with drought, which is not true for places that are used to being wet all the time. When they have a drought, they can actually be in much more of a system stress than we are. But you know, definitely it's a challenge for us, no question. And this drought has been a pretty bad one so far, and we don't know when it's going to end. Now, this is a topic that's been in the news a lot and discussed probably in bars and coffee shops a lot, too. So thought it's maybe useful to just show the numbers and explain a little bit what they mean. You sometimes hear that agriculture uses 80% of the water. You sometimes hear that it uses 40%. Those are both true. It just depends on what slice of the pie you're looking at. And so when people talk about cities using 20 and farms using 80, it's because they're looking at the part that's used by people and businesses. And when they're talking about the total pie of what is accounted for, that includes the environment at about half on average. These are numbers that are on average from 1998 to 2010. I will say that during wet years, the environment gets a bigger share, and during dry years, the environment actually takes a bigger hit because the environment does not have groundwater to pump in general, with, you know, a few exceptions. So all of these sectors are experiencing cutbacks right now, and there's also been some discussion, you know, in the news and in the press, especially over the last month or two, about the share of water relative to the share of the economy. So here it is, just to kind of point it out to you. The farm economy in California, sort of direct farm production and some of the very closely related industries are about 2% of California's GDP. Higher share of labor, maybe up to 4%. If you add in multipliers of sort of, you know, if you stopped all agriculture today, there would be broader impacts than just that 2%. Because of the related businesses and so on. But those multipliers are present in other sectors too. So that's kind of a thing. One can't add them all up and you get more than the economy if you added multipliers from every sector. That doesn't mean that 2% is not important. It's just, that's a fact in the US economy as a whole. The US is an agricultural powerhouse worldwide. Ag is not a bigger share of the economy. The U.S. economy, California is the largest ag state and definitely an incredibly productive, both within the national and the international markets. But it's just that's just the fact in terms of the numbers of what it produces. There's not a value judgment in ag using a lot of water. Part of the reason California's agriculture is so productive and we are an ag powerhouse is because we have great growing conditions if you can add the water. It's actually better if you have sunshine and good soil and don't have rain during the growing season and can add it because then you can control it and be much more precise and so on. So not a value judgment, just sort of the way it is. What it does mean, though, is that a drought does not, the California economy as a whole is not as vulnerable to a drought as agriculture is. For sure. And that's important also in thinking about regions like here that are more ag-reliant in terms of the economy. Just, you know, to give you a sense for the entire San Joaquin Valley, what this pie looks like is quite different. It's on average about 25% for the environment, about 70% for farms, and about 5% for cities. So you just get a sense, you know, ag is an important feature here. So this drought, you know, has been now declared an emergency since January 2014, but the drought is actually in its fourth year. And, you know, droughts have, in California's history, created opportunities for kind of checking in and seeing what do we need to get better at doing. And that was very important for us in the late 80s to early 90s drought, for example. This drought is doing the same thing, and there are some pieces of it that are actually better news than you might have feared, looking at how bad the hydrology is. Urban areas have had limited problems so far in terms of real shortages. Now, they're under the gun now with the governor's executive order to reduce water use, but in some places that's more preventative than because they are in extreme shortage right now. And this is really thanks to a lot of planning and investments that were made over the last 20 years since the last long major drought. The bad news has been painful reductions in the ag sector, with, you know, about 500,000 acres fallowed last year. Supply emergencies in some small communities, and I'm going to show you a map with some dry wells, and then an environmental water crisis in some places. It's been really tough to be a wildlife manager in this drought, and this is in watersheds across the state where problems have been occurring. So the valley here, the San Joaquin Valley, faces some unique challenges. You know, definitely reflecting the California challenges overall, but then, you know, here the farm sector is much more important, both in terms of employment, in terms of the economy. Urban areas are growing fast. There's a high unemployment rate in this region compared to statewide or compared to coastal areas. There's been declining reliability of imported surface water. And the groundwater basins in some places are pretty stressed. And I'm going to show you a graph to just demonstrate that in a minute. And then there's been an increasing recognition of water quality challenges, both for drinking water quality, for folks that are relying on well water, but also in some places for irrigation uses, water that's getting too salty for certain crops. Now, the cities in the region have been asked, or been mandated, I guess. Last year they were asked, and this year they were mandated to reduce water use. So overall, the governor's announcement on April 1st was he wanted a statewide reduction of 25%. But in urban areas, and that's from a 2013 baseline. And the State Water Resources Control Board has gone through and allocated shares of that to different communities based on their existing water use, and I think maybe how well they did. Luke can tell us more about that in the panel. If you look at the communities, 58 communities within this region that are under this mandate, most of them are being asked to reduce more than the statewide average target. And that's because water use in the urban areas has been relatively high here, partly a result of just it being hotter and more single-family homes and larger lots and so on, more landscape watering. But also that a lot of the urban communities have not been water short historically in the way that some, say, Central Coast communities are, where they just don't have the supply, and so they've been having to cut back over decades now. This shows you sort of the pie for 2010 of water use in the eight counties, and you can see that, you know, residential outdoor use is almost half of the total residential use, and there's some pretty significant chunk of outdoor use in the commercial and institutional sector. What the state is really aiming to push cities to do is to reduce outdoor water use to the extent that they can. And I think, you know, hoping that they can maybe get some permanent changes there in the ways that there have been reductions in indoor use in the past. Now, for farming in the valley, there have been definitely cuts in water availability. It's been uneven in terms of not everybody has had the same cuts, so some farmers have been receiving zero allocations relative to what they are contracted for. Others have been held relatively harmless. I don't know if anybody has gotten 100% of their surface water this year, but if you're a senior right holder, you've been doing better at least than getting, you've been better than zero. What this shows you is a distribution of estimates from 2010, which is the last year for which these are available, of water use in the valley, net water use, for different crops, and an estimate of revenues using 2012 price data. And what it shows you is that there there's a distribution of some crops are generating more revenue per unit of water that's applied. And that, in particular, the fruits and nuts, those are the vineyards and the orchards. And then the truck farming and nurseries, that's sort of vegetables and berries and things like that, and nursery plants. Those are really where most of the revenues are coming in directly. Now, some of the field crops down here are going into dairy, so they have an added value that comes from that sector. But what this, if you look at this picture, you can also kind of see tell what people are going to be fallowing first if they're running out of water. And it's tending to be the field crops more, and people are trying to keep their trees alive. Now, we talked about groundwater, and the video also talked a little bit about that. And with the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, this has been on people's minds a lot, and also with this drought. Here in the center, this is showing three lines for the Central Valley for the three main hydrologic regions within the Central Valley. So the red is the Sacramento Valley, the blue is the San Joaquin Basin, and then the yellow is the Tulare Basin, so the southern half of the San Joaquin Valley. And what you can see is that while the Sac Valley more or less has groundwater in balance over the long term, more or less. In the San Joaquin Basin, it's been the groundwater levels have been coming down, and in the Tulare Basin have been coming down a lot. And if we were able to extend this out, we would see significant drops further still. And what this means is that the basin is not being recharged in wet and normal years. It's not. You want to be able to use your groundwater, especially in dry years when you're not getting surface water, but this is a real challenge for sustainability, and I think one of the things that was a factor in play in thinking about the enactment of the new law. And now this is a map that shows you basins around the state that are required to meet the conditions of the new law. These are basins that are considered high or medium priority for a variety of different reasons. And the basins that are all, in addition to that, considered critically overdrafted, which is going to for sure include the areas in the Tulare Basin and some others, they have the shortest timeline for getting into compliance. They have to adopt plans by 2020 and achieve sustainability by 2040. The other basins don't get much. They get two extra years, so it's not like it's a big leeway there. And so what the law does is it gives local agencies the authority to measure use and to charge fees in order to manage the basin. And I'm sure, Dave, you'll be able to talk more about other aspects of the law. The new bond that voters passed in November does have some funding to help with the planning process, $100 million that can go toward that. And achieving balance in basins that where use has been unsustainable is going to require more recharge, and if it's not possible to just get there with additional recharge, it's going to require reducing use. So, you know, probably in some places a combination. And that's going to be a challenging thing to implement, for sure. So another groundwater issue, we talked about water quality being a challenge. There's been a growing recognition of the problem of nitrate contamination, which this is kind of one of the Tulare Basin is one of the real problem areas, along with the Salinas Basin, both very much related to agricultural, decades of agricultural uses of these lands. But other water quality issues too are a challenge. This map shows you small systems, which are systems with basically 1,000 households or less, which are the ones that are in some ways the least able to deal with the problem themselves. It's not a huge share of the state's population. It's a real problem because of the affordability, both on the cost side. When you don't have scale economies, it's very expensive per household to put in place treatment plant, or other kinds of solutions. And these often are households that don't have much in the way of income to start with. So it's a real challenge where outside funding is needed. The state has been recognizing this, and there's money both in Prop 1 and beyond and some changes in administration to make that possible, but it's still a challenging issue, and I know Sue will be able to talk some about that. There have been some proposals for consolidation as a way of kind of reducing the per capita or per household costs, and there's actually a bill right now that's being under consideration that would maybe even mandate that. When people talk about consolidation, you can think of two things. One is when these communities are close enough to a larger system, you can actually physically connect them. But there's also an option of administrative consolidation where there's, you know, they may be far flung, but there can be a management entity that's consolidated that can kind of give you scale economies in testing and oversight and those kind of things. So, talked also about dry wells. Drinking water wells, especially shallow domestic wells, have been going dry in a lot of places. East Porterville is kind of ground zero for that. This was a map done as of April. It's probably got more dots on it at this point, and expect more dots as we go through this dry summer. The state has been on this pretty early on, so one of the first things that the administration did in January 2014 was set up an emergency procedure and get money passed in order to be able to help. But it's turning out to be legally complicated in some cases to help, especially for private individuals and communities that are below a certain size threshold. So that's a continuing work in progress. Just wanted to highlight that storage has been a topic of a lot of discussion. And when you think about storage in California, as that video showed, snowpack is one of those free storages that we've been relying on in California for an important part of our seasonal storage every year. This was where Governor Brown did his executive order announcement on April 1st. He should have been standing on 5 feet of snow. That would be the normal year. And so you can see how snowy it is. It was very, very dry. And this was a combination not just of the fact that it was a dry year, but also because it's been so hot. We've had record heat, so that just made it much, we got more rain relative to snow than usual, and the snow that we got melted quicker. And the projections are that we're looking at snowpack shrinking just as our climate is expected to warm. So in some ways, you can think of this drought as a dry run for the kind of droughts that we're going to be having more in the future that are hotter as well as dry. So, you know, in thinking about the state solutions, and I think these are relevant, you know, for the Valley as well, a lot of us have been talking about the danger of thinking about silver bullets as, you know, that if we just do one thing, that's going to get us out of our problem, that we really need to think of an all-of-the-above approach. And the Proposition 1 bond that was passed really is a kind of all-of-the-above approach in terms of the kind of funding that it will provide. But, you know, thinking about diversifying supplies, especially, you know, for urban areas, but even for ag in terms of recharge, managing demand, and that's a combination of behavior changes, technology, expanding water trading, which can be really valuable for agriculture to get water where it can be most useful, enhancing water storage, and thinking about storage in that way as a system where you're thinking about your groundwater, your surface water, how they interconnect. And then updating institutions, and that's water rates, that's codes to make it easier to do things that are innovative, regulations, measurement. This is just a picture from just south of here, you know, down in Kern County, groundwater recharge basin, the kind of thing that probably with the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act is going to be more and more enabled. So, talked about the survey that was just released, and there are many water questions, so I encourage you to take a look at it on our website, but this is one that is most striking to me, which is, you know, March 2012, so actually in the beginning of the first year of this drought, this is an open-ended question. So it's no leading question, it's just what do you see as the state's top issue? The economy is almost always number one in this answer. We were, you know, still kind of coming out of the recession there, but 52% water, not even, you know, just a blip. And then this latest survey, this is the first time that water's been in a dead heat with the economy since last year, but now it's 39% statewide versus 20, and look at the Central Valley as a whole. even higher. So, you know, this suggests that the public is definitely paying attention to this, and it potentially means an opportunity for promoting some changes that we need in water management. And I'm going to end there. And just this is just a reminder that this is not the first drought that we've had. This was a cartoon from 1991 when it was pretty dry also. So thank you so much. And I'm going to now turn it over to Mark and Ruiz.
Forgive me for smiling, but finally I get to sink my teeth into something really cool. I've been covering water as an issue since Governor Brown's first term in office. I remember covering the peripheral canal. I remember the drought of 1977, the one that everybody talks about. And throughout that time, I grew up in Bakersfield and I covered this down in Kern County. Those folks are really rabid about water, as rabid as anybody else. So now, every time the subject of groundwater came up in the valley, people laughed me right out of the room. Now all of a sudden, we have the kind of drought that everybody's been talking about for a long, long time. And guess what? It has finally happened, and I stuck around long enough to hear it and to say this to you. So I guess what I want to do I wanted to thank Fresno State and PPIC for covering this because I think this issue is so important to all of us. And I hope you guys stay tuned into this because that's the only way this is going to work. 25 years is a long horizon, and that's something we need to talk about with the groundwater rules. Dave Orth from KRDC, Sue Ruiz, and Luke are people here. I'm going to ask you the questions that people ask me, and maybe with it just a little bit more since I've been talking with you guys about this stuff. And so let's just start, and after we're done talking about what we're talking, we'll have 5 or 10 minutes so you guys can ask your questions and you can have fun with this too. Most people don't think this stuff is fun. I don't know why. So I guess with the new groundwater law starting and people like me sitting on the side waiting to see what happens, there are pitfalls that probably everybody's been worrying about for decades and decades. And I guess I wanted to start with that question and maybe start at the end with you, Dave, and ask about farmers, and then you, Sue, with the disadvantaged communities, and then on to Luke with for cities. So if you don't mind starting us off, Dave.
Well, I think it's important to maybe start with an acknowledgement or a point of fact that, you know, we've been doing groundwater management in the valley for the last several decades. Local agencies have adopted groundwater management plans. We've tried to understand how our aquifers are reacting to increased uses and how surface water reliability or the lack of it, which clearly the valley has suffered both in terms of drought and regulatory actions, affects those groundwater actions. But it's been a very voluntary type program. It's informed some planning decisions, but it really hasn't terribly hit home on the farm or at the local water agency level. And so I think the new law kind of moves that into a regulatory structure where we now have a bar to jump over. And if we don't jump over that bar by 2020 and then 2040, as Ellen pointed out, we run the risk of the State Water Resources Control Board coming in and operating our groundwater aquifers until we decide that we really want to manage it to sustainability. I think the pitfalls here are Unfortunately, the pressure of the drought is calling for quick, immediate actions. You know, we've got to solve this problem tomorrow. And yet, you know, as Ellen pointed out, droughts are kind of California's reality, much like floods are and earthquakes. I mean, we have droughts. And it took us a lot of time to get to this place, and the Act arguably gives us some time to get out of it. And so I think one of the pitfalls is to try to avoid this sense of urgency and make poor decisions. Now, that's a hard conversation to have with the people who have the red dots on the map where their wells have failed. And I'm absolutely sympathetic to that. But we have to be careful in not making quick, uninformed decisions. I think this is going to have to start with developing a good understanding of the needs that each individual area are going to have to have relative to groundwater balance. Is it more water supply development? Is it curtailment of pumping by acre? There are a lot of things that we've got to look at in terms of the tools that are available. But we have to be careful. We have to be deliberate, and we have to engage the broader community in that conversation.
Okay. Sue, if you're sitting at home without indoor plumbing, how does this deliberate pace strike you?
Well, I'll piggyback off a little bit what Dave was saying. My background is in education. I was getting my administrative credential. I'm the president of the Easton Community Services District, which is just south of Fresno. About 2,000 people, 550 homes. Everybody's on a private well and septic system. And I was looking at the wet and dry years, and the last time that the community was looking at installing a water system was during wet years. Pre-meters, there weren't any meters at that time. And there was a couple people in the community that did a really good job of PR, and the community turned down the grant that they had to develop a water system. So people shake their heads and say, oh, that's bad. I have a private well. I love the water that comes out of my well. My particular water doesn't have any contamination in it, so I like my well. I was involved with that a little bit. Well, some time has gone by, and now all of a sudden, this well's dry, that well's dry, this one's dry. So now people are saying, we should have done this in 1996. And others are going, yeah. The gentleman who was very effective at turning down the water system in the 90s was just elected to our service district board by one vote. So he's on my board. But that's okay, because I know where he is. And so we are again looking at a water system, and the drought has changed the conversation. So that we, exactly what Dave was saying, informed decisions, that's what we're about. The King's Urban has been extremely helpful in me as a community leader to help people become informed and to respond rather than react. Now, when you don't have water in your house, you tend to react, right? But it's changed the conversation for people to think, okay, I gotta take care of it today, but I also have to think about the tomorrows.
We'll come back to how they're reacting. I want to hear a little bit more about, because I hear all kinds of stories. Luke, cities.
Really at this point, kind of echoing what Dave and Sue have said, we don't want to rush into it. I think the biggest pitfall right now is fragmentation by everybody kind of going off and doing their own thing rather than working collaboratively with each other. We're fortunate around here, like Dave says, we've been working on this for a long time, so we have good relationships between the cities and the irrigation districts, or most of the cities and most of the irrigation districts, between Kings River Conservation District. So we're there, but there's always a tendency in a situation like this that it's going to boil down to a have versus have nots when it comes to water, or cities versus ag. And we don't want to do that. We want to work collaboratively. You know, there's a lot of finger pointing going on that I think is due to a lot of misinformation. Urban users blame ag. Ag users blame the urban users. And everybody blames the environmentalists. And, you know, that just, and it's on talk radio. It's in the letters to the editor. And it's a lot of uninformed decision making. And we need to make sure that that doesn't drive the process, that we don't fragment and build walls around ourselves. And, you know, kind of an I got mine, you're on your own. because the water's connected. So I think we're there. I think we're on that path right now, working together for a cohesive, coherent, collaborative effort to get this under control.
Well said. And speaking of collaborative, cohesive, everybody work together kind of thing, I wanted to bring up Temperance Flat, and a lot of people have asked me what Temperance Flat has to do with groundwater. I have just the gentleman to explain that. Temperance Flat is the proposal to enlarge the reservoir up at Millerton, and the money that's being that can be used from the state from Proposition 1 money is largely going to be, priorities are going to be set by the California Water Commission, and we've got one of the water commissioners sitting right here in Dave Orth. So how's that going to work, Dave? And are we just a shoe-in here?
I would say not a shoe-in. Let me say that as Ellen pointed out, it's clearly recognized and the voters overwhelmingly supported in Proposition 1 the concept that we need to invest in more storage in this state to be able to manage or increase our savings account balance so that when we get into these drought periods, we have water saved both in surface and groundwater to weather, you know, the dry period. And so the Prop 1 set aside $2.7 billion under the control of the California Water Commission, not the legislature, not anybody but the commission, and that causes a lot of people to stop and say, wait a minute, you've got to report to somebody. I guess we're accountable to the public ultimately, but the commission has been charged to develop guidelines and regulations that will define how we're going to allocate that $2.7 billion to invest in expansion of storage in California. The eligible projects include surface storage projects that were defined by the old CalFed program, and Temperance Flats is one of those eligible projects. But it also includes groundwater storage, groundwater cleanup, reservoir reoperation and conjunctive use projects, and even local and regional surface storage. So the commission, in the preparation of our rules and regulations thus far, has recently conducted a scoping survey where we ask people to voluntarily identify projects that they're thinking about that they might bring to us next year. We had 162, I think, projects submitted. So with $8 billion, I believe. Now, these might be a little bit off, but significantly more than the $2.7 billion that we have available. So there's going to be a very competitive process that's required here. The commission only is allowed to fund up to 50% of the project cost, and that is based on a public benefits assessment. The statute basically states that projects have to submit the public benefits they provide and demonstrate to the commission that they provide ecosystem improvement, water quality improvement, flood control, emergency response, or recreation. Not all together, but clearly there's an emphasis on the ecosystem restoration, and that half of the money that we fund has to be for ecosystem benefits in the Delta or its tributaries. So there's a lot of work that's yet to be done to define what is that benefit, how are we going to quantify it, and then how are we going to consider project proposals. Back to your question, is Temperance a shoe-in? Temperance needs to demonstrate that it provides these public benefits. It also needs to demonstrate a commitment to pay for the unfunded or the balance of the capital costs that are not funded by the Proposition 1 Chapter 8 monies, which could be water user fees or federal support. And I think then ultimately where the commission is at these days is that any project, including Temperance, will need to demonstrate how it improves the operation of the state system, and our belief is improvement of the operation of the state system means that those investments have to be integrated with other investments. Expansion of other storage in the system downstream, either local groundwater recharge and storage, or even some smaller local reservoirs downstream of Temperance, so that when we operate them in a coordinated way, in an integrated way, we create a greater benefit. So my challenge has been to the Temperance folks, the people who are very pro-Temperance, is to develop the package that shows those public benefits, that shows the commitment to integration and how that project can improve the operation of the state system, and then I think they'll score very well. If they fail to do that, they will not score and they will not be a shoe-in.
So how does it help the groundwater? I mean, most people I talk to say, well, they can put this into groundwater. Why do we need a reservoir?
Yeah, a good question. I will point out that this isn't a silver bullet solution, as Ellen pointed out. I think we have to make both surface water storage investments and groundwater storage investments to get to that that place that the voters envisioned when they approved Proposition 1. Our flood flows come off of our system so quickly that controlling it directly into a groundwater recharge facility is virtually impossible. Groundwater banks recharge much slower. You have conveyance issues to get the flood water from, you know, where it's flooding to the places where the recharge is optimum, because not every piece of dirt recharges it the same way. You want to find the porous soils that are directly connected to the usable groundwater basins, and often those aren't right next to the river where the floodwaters are occurring. So surface storage allows us to capture and control and regulate the release of the floodwater in pulses that allow us to then recharge the groundwater basins. So again, go back to the commission's view or vision that we create integration of surface and groundwater storage so that we can accomplish both. We don't see it as a one or the other. In many instances, we see it as a both. And I think it's ultimately going to be necessary to do it that way if we're going to reach sustainability.
When are we going to know, Dave?
The law does not allow the commission to award any money out of Chapter 8 before December 15th of 2016. We are aggressively involved in a regulation making process, trying to further define some of the terms that the statute used that really don't have great definition. We have a vast public input process that's underway, and we will submit our proposed rules and guidelines to the Office of Administrative Law by the end of this year, maybe early 2016, and then Office of Administrative Law has to go through a rulemaking process where there will be even more public input. Some folks have suggested that could take up to another year. I believe that the commission right now is on a path by the calendar to probably make funding determinations no later than spring of 2017, and there's a great deal of urgency amongst the commissioners, and we've been pressing the staff to try to move that up much earlier, and a lot of that will hinge upon how long the Office of Administrative Law takes to review and approve the guidelines. But we're at least a year away from having much more definition and purpose than we have today, and probably a year after that before we're writing checks.
Okay, so it's like the process of baking the sausage is kind of all over the place sometimes, but it's the way that they have to do it. But at the same time, if you're sitting at home without indoor plumbing, as the people that Sue works with, you want to see that action now, and the emergency funding that's been coming down. I've talked to a lot of people who are renters. This money doesn't go to renters. I've talked to a lot of people who maybe own the property but don't have any money to fix anything. They don't get the money. There's a lot of people who flat don't have a chance here because of our economic situation in the valley. So I guess that's my question, Sue. the governor wanted to speed things up, put things in an emergency mode. Has that happened?
No. Trying to be nice. I don't know that I would say that it's been an emergency response by any chance, by any means. I think the intent from the state, I was thinking of the analogy being the teacher, that how many of you have written a paper that has great content, real creative, wonderful, but you kind of messed up on the grammar, the structure, the sentence structure. So what grade do you get on that paper? You know, do you get an A for content and intent? Maybe mixed with a D or an F on the actual structure, and so what's the grade? I don't want to make light of this because the state has listened. There's more money now for places like Self-Help Enterprises, which is, if you don't know, is a nonprofit that works primarily with housing, but we also work with small rural communities on their water, wastewater, mostly technical, managerial, financial, helping them do a better job with what they have. Well, now that the drought has hit, we're working with small communities like that don't have a lot of water in their community, but then we've also just really, I tell people we're drowning in the drought, helping with private well communities, particularly that don't have water. So the intent of the state was there. There's sometimes hurdles along the way. Like you said, you know, which one of you was saying the administrative thing takes forever to go through the legal part. That has happened. You know, there's money to pay for tanks to connect to houses and even to fill the tanks with water to actually get water in their home. Well, does the county need to have permits so that everything's health and safety and all the electrical is this and that and so on? And then in another county, well, we need the well driller to go out and make sure that the well is really dry and it's not just a broken pump, so that we actually will spend the money on the tank and the water. Really? The whole street's dry. Do we need a well driller to go prove to you that the well is dry? That conversation is still going on. So I don't know that it's been responded to as a drought in the implementation of the intended money.
Very complex. I've heard stories about in Tulare County where they have a near-term solution, a tank or a centralized well, a midterm solution where they build a distribution in, say, the town of Monson, and then a long-term solution where they hook into a bigger, it's just amazing to me that it has to go through these kind of gymnastics, and a lot of these people have already been waiting for five, 6 years.
And if you don't have water, if you don't have a well with water, you're going to be waiting 6, 12, or 18 months just to get a well driller, even if you do have the money. And today I was curious because we're told that if you don't have water, you can't get a loan to pay for a well. Okay? So I called, I'm going to say their names because they were all responsive in a positive way, the education, the EECU, Education Credit Union, and B of A and Chase are the three that I happened to call today. Wells Fargo's been helpful. They've given some money. Self-Help has some to respond to the drought. And the three people, and they were all, I think they were all Fresno-based banks, that's who I ended up with. And they were all very intrigued. And they all said to me, send me something. Send me some information. We don't even know the whole story. Maybe we can help. Maybe there's something we can do. Maybe we can go to my supervisor. I was really excited about that because there is lack of this financial assistance. Not necessarily give away grant money all the time, but even loans. But when you only have an income of $35,000 or $32,000 a year, it's really hard to pay $30,000 for a new well.
Yes. And along those lines of things that you need to develop, and because there's a lot of people working in earnest to do this across the board, very sincere, but they're hampered or limited by the rules they have to follow. And that kind of helps me turn to the question for Luke. What I remember most about Clovis was the big investment in groundwater banking and how prepared you folks were for this drought. And you were right at the top of the list with the 36%ers who need to drastically cut water because you thought ahead.
Yeah, that the last couple of months have not been a lot of fun. We invested in a partnership with Fresno Irrigation District. We invested $10 million in water banking facilities over the last 10 years, specifically so we could meet demand during droughts. And And to put that in perspective, on a per capita basis, that $10 million is more than the Prop 1 $2.7 billion statewide. So it's a significant investment, and we were planning on investing more. We've invested tens of millions of dollars in a water recycling system so that we can offset our potable use. We've constructed our own recharge basins, and we're really trying to conjunctively manage our resources correctly. So we thought we were pretty much prepared for a drought, as prepared as you can be. So in 2014, when the governor asked for voluntary reductions, we voluntarily reduced, but we didn't make the 20%. We made about 11% reduction because we could meet demand. We had these resources available. So coming into this year in March, we were looking at the snowpack going, wow, this is going to be even worse than last year. And we were working on our plans for how much water we were going to take from the water banking agreements, how we were going to manage our surface water allocation, how we were going to manage our pumping to get us through this year and meet full demand. And we are able to do that if we could. Then on April 1, the governor makes his announcement, mandatory 25% reduction. And we have been working on some things we might do to get closer to his 20% request, but he came out with a mandatory 25% reduction. So at that point, we shifted gears into, wow, okay, this changes things. How are we going to get there? And then a week later, the state board released their draft regulatory framework that said, oh, you're in different tiers. Clovis, you use a lot of water per person, which that's largely because we're single-family residences with landscaping, and that's how we've developed, so we use a lot of water per person. But we made sure we have that water available. So they said, you have to do 35% reduction. And we're like, oh my gosh, how are we going to get there? So I wrote them what I thought was a nice letter explaining some things to them and telling them that any water I pulled out of the bank shouldn't be counted as usage because it was put there for that purpose. We've spent millions of dollars to put it in there, so it shouldn't count as usage. And they responded by saying, Clovis, you're 36%. So I don't write them letters anymore. At that point, I just decided to shut up and not talk to them anymore. So we actually took a pretty aggressive package to our council April 20th. What we're doing is we already had limited watering days. We reduced that from 3 days a week to two. We already have water wasting rules. We're stepping up enforcement on that. But the biggest thing we did is we had no choice. We passed on to all of our customers that when we bill you, we're going to compare back to your usage in 2013. And if you didn't save 36%, we're going to tack a monetary penalty onto your bill. Wow. So it's a pretty aggressive plan. Didn't go over real well with the customers. I was almost afraid to go to that council meeting, but it actually turned out okay. Most of the anger was really directed at the state. Probably more than half of the people that got up there basically told the council to tell the governor to go pound sand. And council had to say, well, we can't do that. We have to do this. So it's going to be a challenge. We've stepped up enforcement. But the first time we catch you wasting water, we just give you a warning and we kind of do an audit. So we're trying to, still use the carrot measure, but it's having an effect. We'll see how we get through this summer. 36% is a lot to cut back. The governor and the state has their slogan about brown is the new green. I'm not real happy with that one. So, we're thinking if your lawn's not dying, you're not trying. If you drive around Clovis, there's actually a lot of lawns that are going dry. I heard a good term from a landscape architect. He referred to the grass as going blonde during the summer. So that's our story. We're just blonding our lawns for the summer. So it's going to be a challenge. 36% is a tough reduction to make, especially all of a sudden. And it doesn't take into effect everything we had done up until this. And that's the real frustrating part. We'd rather invest money in long-term solutions, and the revenue reduction that's going to happen from this, that revenue could have been used for further investment in long-term solutions like more water banks, but instead it's just going away. So it's fun times in Clovis right now.
And it's traumatic. They're going through a culture change. And I mean, all of us are right now. I think Ellen was referring to that. And I sort of wanted to wrap up the questioning with each person to sort of tell us what you think after we go through all this spasm we're going through and it actually begins to rain again. what's it going to look like? What are we going to look like 10 years down the line, 15, 20? How's California going to look? I'll start with Dave.
Is it going to rain a lot or not?
No promises.
Yeah. I thought a little bit about this, and I've been thinking about this for, gosh, the better part of a decade. And we really kind of face two futures, in my opinion. One is the future where we've made the investments, or we've begun making the investments. I mean, the temperance is, or any large-scale surface facility is 20 years into our future, right? But we're either making the large-scale investments in surface storage, and we continue to develop groundwater and local reservoir storage to allow us to capture floodwaters and find balance in the system, which we've heavily invested in and will continue to do that in the Kings Basin here in the Fresno area. And, you know, the state will have found a different balance that creates increased surface water reliability, which has, devastated the valley in terms of reduced reliability of our state and federal project water supply. And that balance only comes by the state making more investments in infrastructure to create water, to find that place where we can meet environmental objectives and contract obligations. So again, I think investment, we are committed and are making rapid changes in investment and our expanded investment, and then finding new equilibrium points. Or we continue doing what we've been doing. And at the local level, we try to scratch out an existence, and we get in the line for little bits of state bond money when it's available. But our lawns will die. The face of agriculture will significantly change. The valley economy will take a deep dive adjustment because we won't have water supply to support it. That's not the future I want, but that is a real future if we don't make the investments and find the new balance and the new equilibrium point that's needed to sustain what we do today.
Thank you, Sue.
I think I'll answer the question by telling you about two communities briefly. There's a cluster of houses, maybe about 150 altogether, on a unincorporated area in the south part of Fresno. Part of it's actually in the sphere of influence of the city, and some of it's just outside the sphere of influence. And I'm speculating that by the end of the summer, those houses are going to be approaching 100% dry wells. I think we're doing surveys right now, so I don't have actual numbers, but in talking to people the last couple of years, first about water quality, and now about I don't even have water, I know we're at least at 50%. And I'm thinking it's closer to 60 and 70, and except for the people who have new wells, we're pretty dry. However, the good part of that is that the city, Fresno, the county, LAFCO, the state, and me doing what makes my mother crazy still, is not taking no for an answer. We're really moving forward with that area being able to connect to the city. So in 20 years, they should have water. That's a good story. Easton, on the other hand, I don't know, because the more wells that go dry, the more wells that get put in. And if you've sunk $30,000 in a hole in the ground, do you now want to give that up and connect to a water system? Do I want to do a really good job of learning from my work with the Kings and what I do at South Help, how Easton might even be able to recharge its own water and be this super wonderful, place where we use water and recharge and all that? And then have a Clovis story? Or do I want to just have my own well? Now, people don't like me to say that, quite honestly, but it's a question I say a lot. It's a statement I say a lot. I think I'll just keep my well. But then again, there's others that can't afford it. Do we help each other? Those are hard questions. I honestly could not say what's going to happen in Easton in 20 years, and I'm leading the way. I don't know.
Yeah, it's tough to say. I mean, will we have the groundwater problem under some semblance of control at that point? Will we allow wells to be drilled? I know of a farm where there's two well rigs sitting on it, and they're going to be there for a year drilling wells continuously. And it's not going to be like your 200-foot well. It's going to be 800, 900, 1,000 feet. Big, big operation.
And those wells, between Easton and Fresno, there's about 5 miles. And I don't want to be throwing anybody under the bus, and I'm glad we have agriculture, but there's a lot of trees that just went in the last 2 or 3 years that are going to be. Now, the good part is we get to keep our green belt between Fresno and Easton now. So that was a good part. But the question I have is, those are up gradient from Easton. What's it going to do to our groundwater when they really pull the water out for their trees? So I can't predict in 20 years.
It's tough to say. I have a feeling Luke has an idea, though.
Yeah, well, first of all, to echo on what Dave said, there needs to be a statewide plan, and that's, you know, and a timeline to get it done, not just plans that get put on a shelf, because improvements are going to be needed. Capital improvements, changes to the system, changes to the market system. That first and foremost, that has to happen, or else it gets really, really ugly. Even with that, there's going to be changes. In Clovis, we're already seeing that. I think an advantage the cities have is we are a water provider manager, and we also have land use authority. So it makes it much more connected for us to tie our land use decisions with our water decisions. So we're already working there. If anybody has been out, we built a park a couple years ago at Sunnyside and Shepherd. And it's kind of a new paradigm for what a park looks like, and it doesn't look like any other park. There's not one blade of grass there, but it's attractive. It incorporates stormwater recharge chambers underneath the parking lot. It's kind of the future way of doing things. And as we grow into the northwest part of town in our urban plan, we're already planning for different water strategies. We've already implemented water efficient landscape ordinances. So we kind of have to get people away from the idea of thinking that landscaping is supposed to look like lush fescue turf. That's a hard mold to break, though, because that's what people want. And there will still be, and contrary, and I know it's bad, and I know the state wants to kill all the lawns, but I can provide the water for that lush fescue right now, too. So I think there needs to be a place for that, but it's going to be more limited. We're in the process of capping 30,000 sprinklers on street side landscaping right now. When this first started coming down, I have a friend that is an engineer for Hunter Irrigation, and I told him, I said, gear up for cap production. And he looked at me and said, what? And I said, you're going to have to start capping sprinklers. And I told him, he went to his bosses, and his bosses kind of laughed it off. And then after the Bee did the article about us out there capping 30,000 sprinklers, he took the article to his boss and said, I told you so, gear up the production line. So there's going to be changes in what we consider normal landscaping. There's going to be changes in how we work together cooperatively. But I think we absolutely must have a statewide plan and a way to get there.
Okay. You've heard from us. I'm sure this has raised a few questions with you. Everyone I've talked to on the phone has got a million questions. So raise your hand. I'll point at you like this.
My name is Joanne Todd, and I am from Bakersfield, California. And in listening to all this, I know everyone in this room is probably extremely concerned about our water usage. What I want to know is, and I know that I love the word collaboration, because that means we're all going to get together and work on this. And my husband and I have been working with a company in Oakland, California, and we have been very successful in helping to reduce water usage 25% on farms, parks, private homes, and golf courses. And we've been very successful with that. And I want to know, with all the people that are saying they have an idea so that we can collaborate, When can we present that to someone in the state? You know, and I'm talking about everybody that has an idea, not just me.
That's a good question.
But we have a savings during drought and non-drought. So it's been really successful.
I don't know. I think we have a California water commissioner.
But are you planning anything like that where we can come together as all these people that have ideas and are using them and working with them?
I would suggest
that, I mean, there's kind of two levels of conversation where that kind of discussion can take place. One is locally and regionally. We have, and many agencies in the Valley have created integrated regional water management planning groups, and they meet regularly and look at, and these are public meetings, they look at where we're at relative to our groundwater management objectives, what types of projects and activities can we undertake. A lot of it is focused on getting state grant money into the region, but look for those regional or local opportunities to have a conversation. The other place is in Sacramento. The Water Commission does serve as a forum, the staff will probably kill me for this, for the public to come in and express ideas, and often either the commission has public comment opportunities, and we've had people come in and share their ideas. We've also had topical discussions where it's an opportunity for the public to come in and use the commission as a forum to advance some thoughts that the commission may not be able to solve, but they can certainly direct to the appropriate state agencies for response.
Most of what we're doing is through word of mouth from other people. And I heard about your wells, and we also have, you know, are working with people that have dried up wells, and we're having success. So I just wanted to share that. And I just want to make sure everybody here is not political, that they really want to solve this problem. Because there are other people that are very political about it, and I don't want it to be them, or just environmentalists.
Yeah, I've noticed a few of those. Your hand went up first.
So, Dave, this seems like a great disconnect to me. Sue believes that she has a choice about the future, and that she can make a decision whether put a well or not put a well. We have somebody else that's guiding the course of our fate. What's the point in thinking about we have an option to put a well? Well, we don't. If the state's going to take over our water supply with a regional control program, why would we even discuss that with people? Why would we even talk about it? Why waste energy and time?
Can you all hear what he's saying?
No.
No. Okay, he's talking about why even discuss having an option in the future when it sounds like the state is walking in to take everything up. Well, they're taking everything over, but regularly.
The decision's already been made.
Yeah, I would argue that the decision hasn't been made. In fact, last year when the discussion about the groundwater management legislation began, I was able to insert myself personally and directly into that process and spent probably one of the most difficult years of my career trying to negotiate something that was aimed at accomplishing several primary goals. The primary goal number one was to allow the local agencies to continue to manage groundwater and make the decisions locally that protect our regional priorities. And the Act gives us that opportunity. The Act says local agencies need to form groundwater sustainability agencies and adopt groundwater sustainability plans that find balance in your groundwater use by 2040. And you saw that data earlier in Ellen's presentation. So the burden is on us to succeed. The risk is if we ignore that obligation, or that opportunity maybe is the better way to put it. If we ignore that opportunity and we fall short, then yeah, the state gets to come in, and the way we structured the law is the state only comes in on an interim basis. They adopt an interim groundwater management plan. At that point, absolutely, Keith, there will be moratoriums on well permitting, there will be harsh restrictions on groundwater use as kind of the stick to force the local agencies to say, wait a minute, we don't like this form of punishment, we're going to do it ourselves and we create our local plan. I think it's up to us to figure out how we adopt a local plan that gives, and I don't think this is moonbeams, people. I think there are opportunities for us to create groundwater management plans that allow us the discretion for good solid land use decisions, for freedom in well permitting, to support, you know, a strong ag economy and freedom of choice on the farm to make the cropping decisions you want to make. But it starts with us figuring out what's the shortfall today and what are the solution components to get to sustainability. So I think it's up to us, and if we do it right, we keep the state out of it, and the state doesn't take over.
And I just want to add a tiny bit to that as a well person. As the county was looking at a working group for the groundwater management, you know, I'm a private well person, and I'm like a little poodle on the Facebook thing that's jumping up and down because an owner is home saying, look at me, look at me, look at me, and they're like, no, because private well people aren't going to do any regulation, which is true. But the conversation needs to go both ways. So Fresno Irrigation District has a working group, and they said, you know what, Sue, come on over and talk to us, you know, about Easton, and I'm saying things about the other communities, so that it can be exactly what Dave was saying, so that we can at least be saying the things that they can go, oh, what about this? What if that whole community of private well people uses too much water and we start regulating them as a community and their land use? At least there'll be some of our thoughts over there so they can think about that. It's not going to be a cut and dry thing, but at least it's going to be there.
One thing that both Luke and David have mentioned, and that is tying water use to, or tying land use to water consumption. And I know there were a couple of people in this room that were at the Board of Supervisors meeting last Tuesday, and our Fresno County Board of Supervisors is going in the opposite direction. They're wanting, in their new general plan ideas, they are proposing, led by the chair, Pachigian, to make more urban development allowable outside the city's sphere of influences. And that means more home construction, more development, more water consumption, especially in the eastern part of Fresno County, for example, where the aquifer is thinner, or up in the foothills, where it's very problematic. And so I'm interested in how are we going to get that group of elected officials to understand the seriousness of this issue. They've appointed, there are two members that served with David on the groundwater sustainability committee for the five county area. But the board as a whole is being led, or is pressing in the opposite direction and is unwilling to listen. And I think the other thing that is going to impact small communities, rural areas, is also involved in this, and that is change in land ownership and these deep wells that you mentioned, Mark, with coming in and drilling for a short-term gain of high-value agriculture, which is good in a sense, but it's outside investment coming in. So those are two things that are going to impact this already huge drop in the Tulare Basin.
Yes, but Bob, I think probably what Dave was talking about earlier, this entire local process, I think that is designed to probably get at what you're talking about. We'll have to come together within parameters set by the state. If we don't meet those goals, the state comes in. It's a very common regulation approach in many environmental issues, same with air. We have time for one more question.
Arm wrestle for it?
Good afternoon. Noah Padamo, California Rural Legal Assistance Foundation. We have an office here in Fresno and Modesto. And earlier in the year, the state came around with a workshop around the Groundwater Sustainability Act and how the communities are going to form the governance structure. And one of the questions that came up was, how are you doing outreach and education to the disadvantaged community so that they're part of the process, so that kind of aren't left out, so that the access and affordability issue and so forth and so on. So what do you see, can you tell me what you see that's going on in that area from all the planning?
Well, Sue can speak to this as well, but within the Kings Basin, we have formed a planning group of some of the primary lead agencies that manage water and the larger cities and the county, Fresno County. And a big part of our discussion is how do we invest in outreach, because the act requires that we engage the affected stakeholder community, that's the people who pump the groundwater, including the disadvantaged communities, in the planning, the governance and the implementation of the sustainability plan. So we've started some dialogue. We've actually engaged the environmental justice community through the Community Water Center, and are we've already been to one of their workshops, and we'll continue an ongoing relationship with them to establish effective communication and outreach strategies with that stakeholder group. We've also reached into the ag commodity areas to try to have equal conversations with the ag pumpers. The Act sets a pretty high bar in terms of stakeholder engagement, and I know that the Department of Water Resources is going to look at that when we submit our agency proposal and ultimately our plan, and will not get passed if we haven't engaged that community. So we're taking it very serious.
And one of the mechanisms to do that very quickly is through the nonprofits. And the state has recognized the value of the nonprofits to provide TA because the agencies don't have staffing. I figured I'm making about $10 or $12 an hour right now with all the overtime I'm putting in, but it's pretty high. Hopefully burgers. But I think the state, because the effort has gone in both directions, agencies and nonprofit and justice groups and so on, the gap is starting to at least have a itty-bitty bridge across it. Wouldn't you say that that's true?
Yeah. So,
especially here in the Kings. The Kings has done, I think, a phenomenal job, my experience as a community person. So if you ever have the chance to encourage the state to keep doing something, tell them to fund nonprofits.
Thank you, panelists.
Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed that. The good news is that we're going to continue the conversation out in the foyer, and I know a few of these folks will be sticking around, and there's a number in the audience here who can address them as well. Ellen has informed me that you have to fill this out with a glass of wine, but no pressure. No, but actually, you still get a glass of wine without it, but do remember to fill it out. It is important. And the last thing I'm going to share is we're going to try to do these every quarter and continue to come out as long as the drought lasts. And then after that, I've been informed we're going to change the topic to floods. So we'll have a lot to talk about in the coming years, and hopefully we'll see you at the end of the summer. But please go outside. We've got drink and food, and be merry.